Good morning. Thank you for being here today. Meadow View United Methodist Church, 768 Summit Road, Eden, North Carolina. It's so wonderful to be back open, and I don't know whether you have a chance to notice the sign out front. I changed. We had our address to be able to get our videos, and we can still get our videos, although it might be a little later this week, and I'll explain why that in just a minute. But anyway, there's a sign out front that says, open Sundays, 11 a.m. So anybody passing by will know that we're open. If they need a place to worship, we encourage them to come and be with us. For our announcements today, Nick's in Georgia. He is working on a movie down there. This is, I think, his sixth movie. And he just finished up last Sunday his second video play that he was in. And he's got another play coming up sometime in a few weeks. He's staying pretty busy with different people, meeting people from all over the United States and some people from around the world that's in some of these things that are video enhanced. So anyway, he's not here to help today, and I'm going to try and get the video on this afternoon. I'm not sure how successful I will be. It may be Tuesday when he gets back that we get it on. That's something I've got to work on. Our mission statement for this church: we will share with others all we know of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, showing God's love and care. We wear masks coming into the church, and we distance ourselves. We have plenty of space for other people to come and join us. Please reach out to others within our membership, our attendance of the church, even in the community, and to just let people know we're thinking about them. That's important. Keep First Methodist in your prayers as their members are going elsewhere. Again, I invite anybody that feels comfortable to come and worship with us here in our sanctuary. Thinking about bingo starting back the third Tuesday in May, I've got to call people and ask if that will work with their schedule and with their being comfortable to do that. And we'll separate out in the church. We can set up tables and spread apart and so forth. And I've got more prizes than you've ever seen in your life. I brought a bunch from Stoneville. Ed and Lois Kizar gave us some things in preparing for them moving. If you're not aware, Ed and Lois sold their house the second day. It was on the market, and they're eventually going to be down a little ways, I think, from Sanford, and they're going to spend part of their time at the beach and part of their time with their daughters for the next couple of years until they can get in their facilities. Do you have other announcements that we need to share this morning? I appreciate Diane and Francis working with a contractor. We had a little leak at the front door, and I think that is solved. So I'm hoping, got my fingers crossed, and I appreciate their work in getting that done. Do we have anybody here with birthdays or anniversaries this past week or this coming week? Please join with me as we have our call to worship. Sing with full voice.
Worthy is the Lamb that was slain.
To receive power and wealth and wisdom and might.
And honor and glory and majesty.
Our first hymn is 130 in your hymn book. You can either stand up or sit down, whichever is most convenient with you. It's Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
Love you, Lord.
Second verse. Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our next hymn is 170. I checked the number. Oh, how I love Jesus, 170. This week? Has anybody been blessed? I certainly have. So I had a hurting tooth and went to the doctor, got an antibiotic, and it feels pretty good today. Just don't know whether it's going to last or not. But I'm thankful for being free of pain for the moment. Others.
Ronald got a good report at the kidney doctor. His kidney level had functioned and come up some, so that was a blessing.
Praise God. Absolutely. Others. God is good.
All the time.
All the time. Amen. As we go to our prayers, we have several that we want to lift up. Deborah Donovan, Ronald Denny, a 14-year-old named Watson down at Duke, Tabitha Godwin, our nation, Bill Abisky, Dee Evans. Do we have others that we want to lift up today especially?
Martha Eames.
Yes, thank you. Okay, I've added Martha to our list. Others?
Rachel Martin.
Rachel Martin. Okay, others? Let's pause for our meditation and our prayers. You've given us to be able to come together and worship and praise you. Lord, be with each of these that we've named aloud and all that you are aware of that need healing. Remove pain, provide strength, help people to respond from surgery and be able to go about their normal activities. Be with those that have all kind of levels of illness, Lord, and just be with them and lift them up and to just help them as is within your will, Lord. Be with those that are grieving. You're the only one that can bring the peace and the comfort that we need at a time like that. Lord, be with those that are economically hurting today. Help each of these to be able to simply provide their basic needs and be able to return to work and a salary that will provide for their needs. Lord, be with all of those that are getting shots. Help them to be able to get the shots and have little discomfort, if possible. Be with those that aren't getting the shots and protect them also, Lord. Be with our country. Be with our border. Our border's a mess. It's a crisis. And Lord, we need help. It's sad to see children dropping over a wall, just falling down to the earth, and pictures of people that just hundreds of people in a small space. It's heart-wrenching, Lord. Help us to be able to do things that would alleviate this and stop it. Lord, be with our church. Help our members to be able to regain their strength, regain their confidence in our church, and when they're comfortable, Lord, help them to feel the need to come back. We are family, and we need each other, and we want to help each other. Lord, we thank you for Jesus Christ, his life, his death, and his resurrection. That we know that by believing on him, that one day we'll have eternal life with you. Lead and guide us, Lord. We ask this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. For those that are here, we have an offering plate. They're in the aisle to put your offerings. For those that are watching by video or people that are at home, if you'll send your offering to Diane Carter, our church treasurer, then we can use that for our bills. I'm going to give you a test in a minute. I'm going to play three songs at the piano, and when I come back, I'm going to ask you what they were. Let's see how sharp you are today. Please listen. Okay, what were the three songs?
Brethren, Jesus.
Yes.
Let there be peace on earth.
Right. Amen. The third one is my favorite hymn of all time. That's my one I like the very best. Our scripture today comes from the book of John, chapter 10. Verses 11 through 18. I'm reading from the King James Version. Again, John chapter 10, beginning with verse 11. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. But he that is a hireling, and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, seeth the wolf coming, and leaveth the sheep and fleeth, and the wolf catches them and scattereth the sheep. The hireling fleeth, because he is a hireling and careth not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and know my sheep, and are known of mine. As the Father knoweth me, even so know I the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd. Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life, that I might take it up again. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Harry Collins and Arch Harris were two saddle tramps who had been drifting all around the southwestern United States for almost a decade. Most people would call them ne'er-do-wells, lacking ambition, purpose, and skills, spending a lot of time playing cards and boozing to avoid the unfortunate experience of landing steady work. They're the kind of guys you can strut sitting down. They've got their pride. They eke out a living by doing odd jobs, helping out on farms and ranches, busting broncos, shoeing horses, moving irrigation pipe, tending cattle or sheep, or working the spud harvest in southern Idaho, stuff like that. They're good old boys, not causing too much trouble. Collins eventually tires of this nomadic life, and he decides to travel hundreds of miles to see Hannah, his wife, the wife that he'd left a long time ago. Hannah gives him a frosty welcome, but she has a farm and figures that she can use some help. She allows him to stay, but only as a hired hand, and so he does. This is an abbreviated version of the plot of a Western in 1971 called The Hired Hand, starring Peter Fonda as Collins and Warren Oates as Harris. These characters offer what we might consider the archetype of the hired hand, that is, a lean but brawny farmhand with a leathery face, perhaps a dirty cowboy hat pulled low over his brow. He keeps busy doing manual labor, wrestling a longhorn or whatever else needs to be done around the ranch. Today, a hired hand might also be referred as a gardener or a slack job, pool boy, But the phrase generally applies to farming or ranch life. Today's gospel reading, the hired hand is linked to the sheep industry. And evidently it's not uncommon for a shepherd to be an employee of the person that owns the sheep. So if you're hired to be a shepherd, what are you expected to do? A shepherd has one thing to do. Keep sheep safe. That's it. The safety and the welfare of the flock is a shepherd's absolute number one priority. This means that a shepherd must find a good pasture for the sheep. He must lead them to safe water. He must be sure that they don't munch on poisonous plants. He must guard the flock against predators. Jesus allures to this job description when he mentions the wolves that threaten a flock. Sheep, for reasons we don't need to explain here, are very vulnerable animals. They're easy targets for predators when unprotected. The expression, a wolf in sheep's clothing, underscores the ease with which a sheep can be singled out for destruction. The duties of a shepherd are famously outlined in the 23rd Psalm. There the psalmist mentions green pastures and still waters. It refers to elements of danger, the darkest valley, the rod and staff of a shepherd. When injured, the wounded sheep will be medicated with oil. In short, that the sheep are the shepherd's life. It's a life that can be dangerous. A shepherd could lose his life if he indeed made saving the life of the flock his primary responsibility. Keep the sheep safe. That's what a shepherd does. If a shepherd does one job, then what does a hired hand do? If someone is hired to take care of the sheep, then that someone has the same responsibility as the shepherd. In fact, he is the shepherd. The hired hand has been hired to be a shepherd. Therefore, the hired hand has one thing to do: keep the sheep safe. Yet Jesus says in verse 12 that the hired hand is not a shepherd. The hired hand who is not the shepherd. But wait, you could also make the argument that there are two hired hands in this scenario that Jesus describes: Jesus and the other guy. Most shepherds do not own the flocks that they tend. Thus, most shepherds in the pastoral life of Jesus' day were in fact hired hands. So in identifying himself as a shepherd, Jesus is using a metaphor in which he also plays the role of a hired hand. So are there two hired hands in this passage or two shepherds? Well, neither. There's a third alternative. Jesus claims that unlike most shepherds, he does in fact own his flock. The third alternative then is that there's one shepherd and one hired hand in the text. The difference between Jesus and the hired hand is a crucial one, but what is it? The difference is this: Jesus has volunteered to do the job for free. The hired hand won't work unless he gets paid, and he can quit whenever he wants to, and usually does. Jesus is a volunteer. The Bible is clear about this from the get-go. Just take another look at Philippians 2 and look at verses 5 through 11. This well-known text describes the voluntary self-emptying of the Son of God. He robbed himself of human flesh. He was not compelled to do so. Who though he was in a form of God, emptied himself. Being born in human likeness, being found in human form, he became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Philippians 2, 6 through 8. When some volunteers do a difficult task, tending sheep, no picnic, that person definitely has to have good qualities. Thank God for people who offer freely to take one for the team, to do the dirty work, to do the suffer no one wants to do. We're glad that there are people like this in the world. No surprise then that Jesus would differentiate between himself and the other guy who is paid to take care of the sheep. Jesus calls himself the Good Shepherd because he's doing this for free. Jesus puts great stress on the passage, on the voluntary nature of his work. He is no Henry Collins or Arch Harris bumming around Galilee looking for a job on a fishing boat, mending nets or gutting tilapia, or for a job tending a flock of sheep or sleeping with them at night. He not only does the shepherding thing for free, but he loves what he's doing. And he loves the sheep that he has volunteered to tend. One time he tells the story of a shepherd that's got 100 sheep. I know you remember the story. He sees that one of them is missing. You know what he does. He secures the 99, and then he goes off in search of just that one lost sheep. He finds it, Luke 15, 4 and 5. You have to love your job to be that conscientious. For Jesus, of course, it wasn't a job. How do we know this? Because not only is he working for free and loving what he does, he's willing to lay down his life to protect the flock or to find that one lost lamb. You don't do that if your work is just a job. The hired hand has a job. The good shepherd has a mission. When the wolf stalks at the door, the hired hand hits the road. A hired hand is paid to watch the sheep. Jesus said he's not paid to die for them. Oh no. When the wolf shows up for an entree of mutton stew, the hired hand flees faster than lightning. He's gone. And he's not coming back. He doesn't care for the sheep, Jesus says. Not so the good shepherd. He offers his life for the flock that he loves. I lay down my life for the sheep, Jesus says. I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. So Jesus sets the record straight. No one is going to take his life. He has voluntarily given it up like a good shepherd for his flock. He will not and did not run from the wolf. He walked to Calvary. He bore his cross. He opened his arms upon the cross to embrace the world. It was a mission and a destiny for which he volunteered. So what does all this have to do with us today? Here's the thing. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was not forcibly detained and executed against his will. He voluntarily surrendered his life. He had the motive, the means, and the opportunity to stay alive. Motive, to stay alive, that means the innumerable host of heaven the opportunity any time that Jesus was ready. This is important. Why? Because a Savior who cannot get off that cross isn't much of a Savior. Now, is he? Matthew's Gospel makes that same point in chapter 27, verses 39 through 42. Those who passed by derided him. Save yourself. If you're the Son of God, come down from that cross. He saved others. He cannot save himself. Of course, the passers-by, the chief priest, the scribes, the elders were right. Ironically, he could not save himself without losing those that he saved. The only way to save others was to resolutely stay on that hideous cross and let people mock him. The only way to save others was to keep his mouth shut, refusing to call on that host of armies ready to come to earth and snatch the Son of God from destruction. Jesus voluntarily laid down his life, denying himself and taking up his cross. Interestingly, it's the very thing he said his disciples must do. In order to follow him, deny yourself and take up your cross. And the tough part, and do this for love. Love for God and love of God's lambs. So, are we hired hands? People who will hire out as long as there's something in it for us? Or are you and I followers, servants, disciples for the love of Jesus and for the love of God? Jesus invites you and me to imitate his example, to lay down our lives figuratively, if not literally, for the sake of the gospel. Are we willing to do that? Let us pray. Lord, again, we thank Jesus for coming to this earth. He didn't have to. For dying on the cross, he didn't have to, but he did it all because of his love for us. Help us to love Jesus and others in return. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Our closing hymn today is page 140, Great is Thy Faithfulness. 140. Have a blessed week. We hope to see you and others next Sunday. For those watching our video, we thank you for doing that and wish you also a very blessed week. And now, go in peace. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.